Hello everyone, I am Dr. Bhanu Pratap, Faculty of Law, University of Lucknow, and I'll be delivering a lecture on the topic of ethics and good governance. This lecture will be divided into various sections. The first section will be dealing with the aspect of philosophy. The second part of this lecture will be dealing with the legal aspect. As far as the philosophical aspect is concerned, I'll be talking about the concept of morality, moral theory, and applied ethics. It is my argument in this lecture that the concept of good governance is a wider application of applied ethics. And good governance as such is a part of a post-liberal agenda. It is a primarily an economic phenomenon, and we'll get there when we try and create a nexus between good governance, ethics, and applied ethics. Now, as far as the philosophical part of this lecture is concerned, I'll be dealing with three terms: morality, moral theory, and applied ethics. And I'll be arguing that morality and moral theory are merged into a single concept called applied ethics. And good governance is nothing but a particular application of applied ethics. Now, as far as morality is concerned, in simple terms, we can say that morality is concerned with the idea of good and bad. We know what is good, we know what is bad, we know what is good, what is evil, and we avoid the evil aspect and we do the good things. At times, it is possible that a person may be doing something good without knowing the theoretical or scientific application of that morality. Now, how can we distinguish good from bad or good from evil? That is the particular application of moral theory. Now, it is possible that a person may be a highly virtuous person or highly moral person without knowing the scientific application of morality. He may be good without knowing the scientific principles of moral being. He may be a good person without knowing the nitty-gritty applications of philosophical ethics. Now, as far as moral theory is concerned, moral theory is talking about the scientific application of good and virtuous things. It is the theoretical aspect of morality. Moral theory, in a nutshell, is more academic in nature. Morality is something that we do in daily life. So, moral theory is giving a scientific base to our daily decision-making theories. Now, as far as applied ethics is concerned, applied ethics is a particular legal, political, economic phenomenon, and it took place within a definite political, social, legal framework. Now, the work area of applied ethics is the time period of 1950s and 1960s. 1950s and 1960s is working under the dimension of something that is called postmodern world. Anything that follows 1945 comes within the domain of postmodernism. Postmodernism must be distinguished from modernism. Modernism is primarily characterized by the notion of surety. Postmodernism is characterized by skepticism. Now, after 1945, the world had witnessed two world wars, and it had seen some uncanny and cruel events like Holocaust. So, as such, the faith in humanity, the faith in the legal, political, philosophical system was shaken. Rationality was no longer in vogue, but what was in vogue was the critical method of thinking. This critical or skeptical mode of thinking gave birth to various concepts, and one of these concepts was applied ethics. Now, as far as applied ethics was concerned, it was dealing with one issue only. Is there a possibility that the philosophical virtues or the philosophical values can be applied in a social political framework or not? If we are talking about justice, and justice as an abstract system, can it be applied in real political social life? This was the main idea behind the notion of applied ethics. Now, as far as applied ethics is concerned, its main area of concern was United States of America and Great Britain. United States of America has always been called the land of the brave and home of the free. Now, the particular political legal situation of United States of America were very different. The 1950s produced an era of baby boomers, whereas 1960s was an area where there was mass distrust among the American people with their political system. If America is to be seen as the land of the brave and home of the free, then how come there was still racial hatred in the 1960s? How come America was still involved in neo-imperialist activities like its involvement in Vietnam. The assassination of John F. Kennedy and the assassination of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King further deteriorated the situation. Now, as far as the application of the applied ethics is concerned, a new breed of scholars started speculating on the idea whether values, virtues, or philosophy can be applied in a social political system or not. One of the leading examples of applied ethics was John Rawls' theory of justice. Now, Rawlsian theory of justice is nothing but a practical application as to how the values of justice can be incorporated into the capitalistic America. Can there be a society that is primarily based on justice and not on any utilitarian values? Can individuals divest themselves of their merit in order to come together in a contractarian form and form a just society? So, along with the theory of justice and its subclauses of veil of ignorance, Pareto's optimality, John Rawls' theory of justice came to be known as one of the finest examples of application of the applied ethics. Now, John Rawls, along with Amartya Sen, Robert Nozick, they became the forerunners of applied ethics. Now, applied ethics is almost universal in nature. Its application can be seen in legal science, its application can be seen in economics, political science, political theory, philosophy, actuarial sciences, you name it, you have it. Now, it is my argument in this lecture that good governance is nothing but a particular application of applied ethics. Now, let us consider the concept of good governance. Good governance is particularly a political economic agenda. Now, there is a reason why I'm using the word agenda, because good governance is mainly used in a utopian way. We think of good governance as a sense of entitlement. Good governance in common and popular parlance is seen something that is an entitlement of the citizen, or in simple language we can say good governance is the right of the citizens. But if we trace its origins, we can clearly see that it was a neoliberal agenda. Its requirement was for something else, but later on it became a part of right-based jurisprudence. Now, what exactly is good governance? Now, good governance, as I had already mentioned, is nothing but a particular application of applied ethics. Good governance, the term was coined by the World Bank report published in the year 1988. Now, IMF and World Bank were working on something that was called SAP, Structural Adjustment Program. A Structural Adjustment Program was an elaborate scheme where the economic policies of USA and Western Europe, called the Bretton Woods system, were to be applied or superimposed on third world countries. If the third world countries were asking for loan waivers, then IMF and World Bank said that we are having only one stipulation. If you want loan waiver from us, you will have to liberalize your markets. And in order to liberalize your markets, the only thing that we want is privatization of all your sectors. Now, privatization was a key economic reform that was triggered by the OPEC crisis. Margaret Thatcher famously gave the abbreviation TINA, there is no alternative but to privatize. And good governance was a byproduct of this elaborate economic scheme. Now, as far as good governance is concerned, it is primarily dealing with two variables. Number one, there should be transparency in the government and there should be no red tapism in the administration of a country's bureaucracy. Now, when the third world countries were asked to liberalize their markets, they were said that if the foreign companies are going to invest in your countries, number one, we want a dependable and predictable executive, an executive that is not going to backtrack from its economic policy. And number two, we want a bureaucracy that is not corrupt in nature, someone that does not demand bribe. So, in today's Indian legal parlance, we usually connect good governance with the concept of bribery. But, as we can clearly see, good governance itself was a political agenda. And its byproduct is primarily utilitarian in nature. Now, as far as the concept of good governance is concerned, it is dealing with two issues, transparency and accountability. Transparency, as I had already mentioned in its original concept, was dealing with a neoliberal agenda that a third world country's administration should be free of corruption. Now, being a political agenda, it slowly merged itself into right-based jurisprudence. Now, as we can see in the Indian scenario, the post-1990s world was known as the LPG model, that is liberalization, privatization, and globalization. This LPG model gave applied ethics a wider ambit. And it is within this ambit that applied ethics came to be incorporated with the concept of good governance. Now, in the post-1990s world, India fully embraced the human right jurisprudence. Human rights as such was another Western-backed philosophy. In the Constitution of India, we talk about fundamental rights and not about human rights. Human rights is something that is primarily guaranteed by the conventions of international law. Now, India had signed and ratified various international conventions, including International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, Convention on Rights of Children, CEDAW, and various other conventions. Now was the time to implement those international commitments into our municipal system. Now, let us see how this concept of applied ethics, good governance, and ethics can be applied in the legal manner. Now, as far as Constitution of India is concerned, it is dealing with the fundamental rights in its Chapter 3. There are so many fundamental rights, all of us are aware of that, but I will touch upon the three fundamental rights. That is Article 14, Article 19, and Article 21. Article 14 deals with right to equality, Article 19 deals with freedom of speech and expression, and Article 21 talks about the freedom of life and liberty. Now, as far as good governance is concerned, it can be seen as an antidote to corruption. And corruption can indirectly be seen as a violation of right to equality, freedom of speech and expression, and right to life. Now, right to equality says that as far as law is concerned, there has to be equality before law and equal protection of law. This is the language of Article 14. Now, consider the concept of corruption. If someone bribes a public administrator or a public official, he or she can get her work done quickly. And then we can see another honest citizen who does not give bribe. So he does not get access to all these facilities. He does not even get access to justice. So in a hypothetical manner, the concept of corruption is a violation of right to equality because the person who is bribing an official is able to get his things done as compared to an honest or poor citizen. So the concept of corruption was not only eating away the Indian legal system or the Indian political system, it was also seen as a direct attack on our constitutional moral values. Corruption was also seen as a violation of right to life. This was happening because corruption was creating a parallel economy, an economy that was unaccounted for and that was outside the ambit of the IRS. This money was not accounted for and was not being used by the government. So it gave rise to a parallel economy or black money. And all this was being done at the expense of the public exchequer. So we can see that corruption was not only a social issue, it was also a constitutional and legal issue as it was violating Article 14, 19 and 21 of Constitution of India. Now, as far as the right-based jurisprudence is concerned, the concept of good governance slowly took its roots in the Indian legal system. Now, if we have to talk about good governance, we have to make a special mention to the Right to Information and Prevention of Corruption Act. Now, as far as right to information is concerned, it is one of the fiercest tools that has been added into the quiver of good governance. Now, as I had already mentioned, corruption became a very big issue. Now was the time where the Indian legal structure had to create an act which could provide the basic values of good governance, that is transparency and accountability. This came with the idea of right to information, but it was not an easy task. Now, the Indian legal system or the Indian statutory system is still eclipsed by the British legal system. Some of the acts that had been made in the colonial time still exist, some for good, some for worse. One of these acts was the Official Secrets Act. Now, Official Secrets Act was created by the British because some of their clerical officials were involved in the leakage of some of the war documents that were related to Anglo-Russian war. In order to prevent the leakage of documents, in order to prevent the leakage of war documents into the domain of public, was created the Official Secrets Act, which clearly gave a blanket protection to all the administration and public officials. That means whatever was deemed was being done by the government officials, the Official Secrets Act protected it. Whatever maladministration was being done, that was being protected by this act, as the public could not scrutinize the public documents. Now, this was seen to be a colonial act. Now, with the advent of 20th century and with the advent of human rights jurisprudence came the new concept of right to information. Now, the right to information era, it started way back in the year 1997. In 1997, in the Conference of Indian Press Bureau, the concept of information was used for the very first time. But instead of the nomenclature of right to information, what was used was the freedom of information. Information was seen as the basic fundamental right of the citizens. The Supreme Court of India, in the famous case of Vineet Jain versus Union of India, said that information is the basic right of the citizens of India. The right to know. Right to know implied that the citizens have a right to know what the government is doing, what public officials are doing, and they have a right to access to these public documents. So public document is nothing, something that is sacrosanct. So with the help of these judicial pronouncement, the right to information was given a firm root. Now, in addition to the right to information movement, another important concept called PIL, public interest litigation, this also allowed the freedom of information, right to information movement to gain a strong foothold in the Indian legal system. The public interest litigation liberalized the locus standi rule. The locus standi simply means only the aggrieved party could approach the court. But the Supreme Court liberalized the locus standi rule and said that if there is a bigger social or public interest involved, then even if a person is not concerned with the case, even he can approach the constitutional courts, that is the high courts and the Supreme Court under Article 226 and under Article 32, and the Supreme Court will allow it as a writ petition. Even a letter written to the Supreme Court asking questions about the remedies in the public system can be entertained as public interest litigation. This came to be known as epistolary jurisdiction. So on one hand, you had an activist judiciary which was liberalizing the ambit of Article 21 and incorporating the human rights agenda into the fundamental rights agenda. And on the other hand, you had a complacent legislature that was not incorporating the principal values of good governance into a statutory act. Now, the situation changed with the advent of the Right to Information Act. The MKSM, the Kisan Sabha Sangathan of Rajasthan, they started a movement. It was a social political movement which said that they wanted to know their wages. The laborers wanted to know the rate of their wages in the remote areas of Rajasthan. And this social political movement by MKSS, by the Kisan Sangathan Seva, this became the first phase of Right to Information Act. Now, Right to Information Act had the blessings of another international treaty called Convention Against Corruption. India is a signatory and to the Convention Against Corruption, and it has also ratified the treaty. So the time was ripe to incorporate those international commitments into a municipal act. Now, as a result came the Right to Information Act in the year 2005. Now, as far as the definition clause of right to information is concerned, it talks about information and right to information. Now, information is primarily related to the government documents. This government document can be present in any form. It can be present in the form of an act, it can be present in a form of an essay, it can be present in a form of gazette, in the form of record, electronic, print media, you name it, in any type of form it is present. And if there is any information present in any of the prescribed forms, then the citizens have a right to access that information. This information can be accessed through a copy, through a photostat copy in print form, it can be stored in a hard drive or any other form. Now, as far as right to information is concerned, the only thing that has to be done by a citizen is to get a form of RTI that's worth hardly rupees 10, and he can apply a right to information in that form that he needs some query on this particular issue, and that can be applied in a particular government office. Now, after the enactment of RTI, it became imperative for every government office to have something that is called PIO, Public Information Officer. Now, this particular Public Information Officer was the recipient of all the queries of the citizens. Once he had received the query from the citizen, it was imperative upon him to process that request. So, Official Secrets Act that I had mentioned earlier was of no use. RTI was given an overriding effect on the Official Secrets Act. So, as such, there was no veil between the government officials and the public. The public had full access to the government documents, including some exceptions for obvious reasons. Now, the Public Information Officer was primarily responsible for providing information to the citizen. Now, as far as Section 8 of RTI is concerned, it talks about certain sensitive information which cannot be given to the citizens. I'll not go detailed into the Section 8, but primarily these are those issues which are directly connected with the sovereignty and integrity of the country, something that is related to the IPR protection, something that is related to trade secret, something that is related to the foreign relations between two countries, something that obviously cannot be provided to an ordinary citizen, and it is the sole domain of the government itself. Except for Section 8, everything is now available in public domain. Now, as far as right to information is concerned, it has given certain time frames for information to be accessed. That means a public information officer just cannot sit over an application. He has to provide the information in a particular time period. Usually this time period is 30 days. At times it can be 45 days, depending on the sensitivity of the information. And if the information is related to the life and death, or the or if the question of human rights is involved, then information has to be provided within 48 hours. And if the public information officer is unable to do so, then a first appeal lies to the person who is in senior rank to the public information officer. And in case the public information officer is not able to give, and even if the first appeal is not working, then the Act provides a provision of second appeal. The second appeal usually lies with Centre Information Officer or the State Information Commissioner. Then they have to dispose of this application within 90 days of the receipt of the application. And even certain pecuniary limitations are also imposed on the public information officer. If a public information officer is deliberately delaying the access to information, then he will be charged rupees 250 per day to maximum limit of 25,000 per day. So, right to information became a very important part of good governance agenda. In addition to this, we have the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988, which prevents the concept of corruption, but it is a special act. It is not a normal penal act as given in IPC. But Prevention of Corruption Act had its own limitations. Its application was political in nature, and the officials were able to circumvent the system and they were let off easily. So it's not that right to information was the first act which was dealing with the issue of corruption and good governance. In addition to RTI, we had Prevention of Corruption Act, but Prevention of Corruption Act was seen as an extension of Indian Penal Code. RTI has incorporated the notion of good governance and corruption in its full formula. Now, as far as the Indian legal system is concerned, the Indian legal system has incorporated the concept of human rights, fundamental rights, and good governance not only in its statutory provisions but also in its constitutional legal history. The present Indian legal culture is a typical application of right-based jurisprudence, applied ethics, good governance, and corruption. Now, as far as the concept of corruption is concerned, corruption is not only a political economic formula, it is also a social problem. In a recent case in declared by the Supreme Court has given a very well-scathing attack on the concept of corruption itself. In one of the leading judgments of Supreme Court, the Supreme Court judgment starts in the following words: greed is good. Now, with this sentence, the greed is good, the Supreme Court judges were initiating a tongue-in-cheek irony that the present Indian economic system, the LPG model, itself is responsible for spreading the roots of corruption in the Indian legal system. Now, so far we can see that the LPG model had incorporated the notion of good governance, but at the same time, it is also introducing corruption in another way. This is being done with something that is called crony capitalism. Now, with the advent of MNCs, the multinational corporations, and with the advent of the SAP model, the Indian economic system changed drastically. If we go into the roots of the Indian constitution, the mode of economic structure is socialism, but the economic structure that we can see is capitalism. So in its judgment, Supreme Court said that capitalism as such is a very big issue, because as such, capitalism is not a problem. The problem lies in somewhere else, and that is called crony capitalism. And the government is working in a close nexus with MNCs, something that is giving birth to crony capitalism. And the leading example of corruption and good governance was the 2G Spectrum case. Now, 2G Spectrum case is one of the leading examples of incorporation of applied ethics, corruption, and good governance. The waves of telecommunication were given to certain preferred companies, and this allocation of wave was not done on the basis of merit. The allocation was done on FCFS basis, first come, first serve basis. So the 2G Spectrum case was arguably one of the first cases where the Supreme Court incorporated the notion of applied ethics, good governance, corruption in the legal domain. And it was of the view that as far as the concept of good governance is concerned, we have only incorporated one aspect of good governance, and that is right-based jurisprudence. As far as our economic structure is concerned, it is still marred and eclipsed by crony capitalism. And when I say crony capitalism is a particular application of favoritism. So as far as the 2G Spectrum case is concerned, for the first time, Supreme Court said that the government policies was nothing but a very big bluff with public exchequer and with the tax of the Indian economy. So as such, good governance is concerned, good governance and ethics are not to be seen as a particular political social problem. It's not something that is the sole domain of the state or the government. It is something that has to be incorporated into our soul. The notion of merit, virtue, and truth and justice have to be incorporated into our daily activities and in our daily conduct. And when we understand all these issues, and then when we start working at an individual level, only then can we say that we have incorporated both the aspects of ethics and good governance in our daily life. With that, I'll conclude my lecture. Thanks for having me.